be seeing all these transformations now. I love the conversations that I have at, with audiences like yourselves at venues, whether they are a few dozen people or thousands of people in conversations with the privilege of being physically together or in online fora. As a member of the faculty and an advisor and investor at Singularity University, I was able for the past 10 years to really absorb and intimately think about what is the power of exponential technologies disrupting, not only Netflix replacing Blockbuster or Kodak being swept aside by digital cameras in your phone, but how are our fundamental socio-economic organizations being transformed? And I created first a think tank based in London that is now in 40 countries, Network Society Research, that looks on the ground how people live this change and how local and central governments are promoting or hindering with their policies what is going on. I created a venture capital investment fund that selects seed stage startups to invest in, passionate creative teams that are catalyzing through their technologies, products and services, what we are seeing happening all around. Literally from Shanghai to Cape Town, where I was last week and where we closed our most recent investment. And Network Society Lab, an advisory firm that prepares through venture development efforts companies towards their ICO. The socio-economic evolution that we are seeing thanks to rapidly accelerating technologies are delivering what our ancestors were not even able to dream about. It is very important, if you were to ask an Egyptian slave if his life was just, the answer would be no, obviously not. And then you ask him, can you imagine a society that is not based on slavery? He would say, I have no idea, it's impossible. We have to build a pyramid. Look at that. Our moral ambitions are embodied and supported by the technologies that we have available. And the world that we are living in requires a firm belief in science, in technology, in reason that brought us here. That is the only difference we have with the dinosaurs. They didn't have telescopes. And whether we are talking about the metaphorical telescopes of our imagination or the real ones that the United States Congress defunded and Paul Allen, the co-founder of Microsoft, had to step in to turn them back on, to keep monitoring asteroids that potentially could wipe us out, we have to progress on accepting the challenges that we have. Governance and policy making are a technology that serve us very well. And the hierarchical organizations that were required in order to organize and structure and deploy resources, whether they were the feudal system or whether they were the traditional enterprise, produced the material world around us. Today we are seeing the emergence of an alternative, a decentralized organization based on networks that are going to be more resilient, more adaptable, and ultimately they are going to outcompete what we were seeing before. This is the fundamental thesis of the Network Society, that widespread social and economic change only happens once a solid technological basis makes it sustainable. And that indeed, the globally distributed and decentralized technologies that are emerging are allowing superior results with the previous generation of centralized and hierarchical ones. And finally, that these are unstoppable and they are undermining and disrupting the nation states supporting pillars. So, what are these technologies that I'm talking about? Many of you, almost all of you, maybe everybody here, knows about blockchain and how powerful we believe it is. But let's look at it in a broader context and realize that many technologies are going in the same direction. Imagine rather than deploying $1 billion in a carbon, gas, or oil, or nuclear plant, where you have to wait for 20, 30 years to know whether you have the ROI that you desire, letting aside the environmental issues, you can ask your neighbor, hey Jim, you put on some solar panels a few months ago, how is it going? Are you having fun? Is it working out? And if he answers no, nothing changes. If he answers yes, then you will consider putting up some solar panels on your roof as well. And spreading virally, being adopted by communities one by one, the decentralized nature of solar energy is redesigning completely what the equation about making energy available in a community is. And in many places that have billions of people, the traditional way of providing energy will never materialize. Similarly, how in the 80s people would say, Africa will never have a phone system because there is enough copper in the world to lay down the cables, and lo and behold, they leapfrogged that era and now they are happily using mobile phones. There's no reason to deploy a traditional centralized electric grid, and Africa and India will be based on microgrids very nimbly and adaptively communicating with each other. 3D printing and manufacturing that allows a rapid iteration of what you are doing and accrues the value to the designer rather than the owner of the means of production. Hydroponics in food, cultivated meat, personalized health, peer-to-peer learning, blockchain in finance. The trust networks that Airbnb and Uber are designing, unstoppably outcompeting police in efficiently managing dispute resolution with a rate of positive outcomes that violence-based systems will never be able to achieve. And of course, the hardest of all, which is algorithmic, rational, debating, approving, implementing, measuring, and updating the very rules of coexistence. So you can read as many articles in the mainstream press about Bitcoin dying as you want. And there is, many of you are familiar with it, a counter of how many times Bitcoin has been declared dead. And I think we are like 120 now. But whether those articles or others that are saying, oh my God, the solar is all a scam because you don't realize that the energy created to produce the solar panels is actually polluting more than the solar energy created by blah, blah, blah. And then you can apply some critical vision and ask yourself why that article is being written and who benefits from changing minds around those articles and so on. But what these series of examples should let you understand is that the transformation is unstoppable, that it is a broad and deep change across many different uncorrelated technologies. And if it is, what we need to understand is how to cope and what is the set of behaviors and knowledge and access to tools that we must require in order to build the world ahead of us. Because the new organizations are incredibly empowering for the individual and the communities, emancipating people who can get their hands dirty. There is zero obstacles to knowledge and to practice. You can learn, and while you are learning, you can teach. There's no reason not to spread what you learn to your friends, your family, or online to any communities where you participate. And only that way we can, by aggregating similarly minded people, have the dignity of the societies that we are building, of communities that are sustainable and that know that they have a place and they have a purpose, that the 21st century is of generative power rather than destruction. And of course, the incumbent powers are concrete. Conspiracy theories, unfortunately, are not true. It would be wonderful if there were a small group of people who knew what is going on. Wouldn't it be great? Even if you are not one of them, you just say, oh, they know. Oh, it's so good. But the situation is that the more powerful you are, the farther and the larger you see how big your challenges are. And the bureaucracies are extremely resistant. That is their purpose, to self-perpetuate. And they are in a literal state of panic around these changes that they are seeing. Like an immune system, if you are allergic to nuts, that tells you, you want a nut? Oh, I'd rather kill you than let you have a nut. In the same way, these bureaucracies are not letting any experimentation happening in a search of solutions to the problems we have. A couple of years ago, the state of Hawaii woke up one day and said, oh, solar? We don't want any more solar. Because there was some law on the books that said every solar panel has to be connected to the grid. And the island's utility said, oh, I cannot take it in anymore. Too much power coming in. Very rational conclusion. It took them a year of being the laughing stock of the world to realize that what they needed is a change in the regulation system. 23andMe provides you with genetic kits, personalized genetic kits. And like Martin Luther, who dared to translate the Bible in German so that anybody could read it without the intermediation from Latin of the sacred God of the sacred word of God, igniting a couple of hundred years of war with Rome and the Vatican, the FDA tells you that you are all stupid. You cannot be allowed to directly access and read the sacred code of your DNA. You need the intermediaries of the priesthood of doctors in order to gain that prohibited knowledge. And they are now, after 3 years, with great difficulty, trying to find what the new balance can be, where basically you get access to the knowledge that you have curly hair or not, based on your DNA, and it is a great party trick. But everything that is health-related is being made inaccessible again. Or, most relevant to this group, New York, after 100 years or so, basically saying, okay, why don't we stop being the financial center of the world? Making the BIT license so cumbersome that proportionately today is easier to start a new bank than not running a Bitcoin business in New York. But we can tell them that since these changes are indeed unstoppable, there is no reason to panic. We can tell them that we can hold their hands. And whether that is power to regulate or whether it's the power of money, we must reassure the 1% that they will be fine. They need our help. And whether you identify with the 1% or not, the point is that we are in a human civilization together, and whether we live or die is based on us staying calm, staying rational, and keeping our fucking hands away from the nuclear bomb.
Good point.
When what we call today the car, the automobile, was born, the first people engineering them thought, oh, of course, they are a carriage without a horse, a horseless carriage. And these were those things that were exactly a carriage without a horse. You can actually, that is what I should have done. I should have designed an invisible horse in front of it, right? And today, a lot of people thinking about the shape of the future societies are thinking about what would be the shape of the nation if we took the horse away. But we have to unshackle our imagination. We have to realize that thanks to technology, both our ways of living as well as our moral ambitions are going to be completely different. Something that to me and to some of you is completely evident is that the new societies are not going to be geographically confined. They are going to be totally network-based, and you may have, hypothetically speaking, two passports. One is your American passport, and the other is residing in your pocket, maybe from Bitnation, and you are mugged in Bangkok. And the day you will say, you know what, I'm not going to the US consulate, I'm just hitting the button, and help will spring into action in the network that I belong to, allowing me to both be protected and regain access to my Bitcoin wallet and whatever else I need to be just fine. Similarly to how cloud-based computing today makes you maybe more than shrug if your computer is stolen, but or your data is just fine. And that day when you will decide to use the Bitnation app rather than your US passport is when there will be a flipping point in the power balance between the new nascent network societies and the old, pitiful, extremely mortally dangerous nation states. Ecologists are just fine people who like nature, and some of them like nature so much that in their view, a planet without humanity and with a nature perfectly preserved would be potentially better than not the scrouge on the planet that we represent. And that is admittedly the extreme. There is another group that I find especially unnerving that around June every year starts saying, oh my God, we exhausted the resources of the planet. And now to the end of the year, we will keep eating up additional resources, depleting the planet. And can you please all turn off your air conditioning, stop eating meat, and stop driving cars, and do everything else is needed in order for, you know, recover what is, according to them, some hypothetical natural state. And what I imagine is a group of ecologists 100,000 years ago, a group of Neanderthals, that were entering a new valley, and there were two of the Neanderthals saying, oh, look at our women picking all those berries, and our men sparing all those deer and our wizard collecting all the various kinds of weed he tries to smoke to find the best ones. It is already 1,000 of us. We reach the carrying capacity of the planet, which should be completely alarmed because this is not going well. And the absurdity of this example makes you understand that the path we are on is a very interesting dynamic. We have no guarantee on the outcome. We may or may not succeed, but we have to use our smarts. This is the example I want to end with. You can think of our carrying capacity in the biosphere as defined by the availability of solar energy and oxygen, right? And to be generous, it is 1 mile up, 1 mile down, not even. But the technosphere is expanding at a faster rate, and the biosphere is becoming an important subset of the technosphere. And applying the technosphere, we can increase the carrying capacity of the planet to support not 7, but maybe 70 billion individuals. We have the power, for example, of starting to dig and bring down the solar energy at arbitrary depth, and with hydroponics, and with LED lighting, and with cultivating meat, provide food. We are already bringing mass at far higher altitudes than any biological entity has ever been able. At 200-300 miles of altitude, where the atmosphere is not interfering, and we will keep populating that volume, extending the carrying capacity of the planet. So these examples hopefully inspire you to really get involved, to get your hands dirty, to go out, to start building. Keep your eyes open because the nation states are extremely mortally dangerous, and to experiment alternatives that we can all embrace and thrive on in the 21st century. Thank you.